So Dr. Carrington is a registered psychologist who has been living the dream. A practicing psychologist since 2005, she's worked in Nova Scotia and the Alberta Children's Hospital here in Calgary. Her family then moved to Olds to raise their children. The dream of having a rural private practice developed, and now Jody's big love is to speak to most anyone. As you probably noticed when you came in, she was speaking to us all, and we're so pleased to have her here. To speak to us all about the power of relationships and listening to anyone who wants to tell their story. Jody's learned the power of relationship, empathy, connection. She has learned that these are important for anyone who might want to understand their story and shift it in some way, or heal in some way, or repair it in some way, or change their story once and for all, so that their next chapters as teenagers, spouse, parent, or friend can be better. Jody has worked with adults and children as well as families. So at this point, if you'd please join me in welcoming Dr. Jody Carrington.
How are you friggin' doing? Huh? You are out with blue cheese, fruit, and no children. For some of you, it's a date night. Huh? Holy mother, I am so excited to be here tonight because I don't have my children either, which is really so one of the best parts of my whole day. This sounds a little marbly. Are you okay? Is it better if it's down here? No. All right. I'm going to do my best. Okay. It is such an honor, a pleasure for me to be here tonight. I'm going to tell you a little bit about how this whole thing started, and then we're going to spend some time. If you have any questions, write them down. We're going to make some time at the end of today to talk a little bit about anything you want to ask me about, almost anything you want to ask me about. So I actually did a lot of work in Calgary. Some of my children's hospital loves are here, where we tried to change the world there for a short period of time. But where I grew up was Viking. Does anybody know Viking, Alberta, Canada? Woo! No? Okay. So home of the Sutters. This is our claim to fame, home of the Sutters. And that's about all. The Kinsella gravel pits are near. So listen, I knew I wanted to be a psychologist really early because I was inspired by a teacher. Grade 10, graduating class of 28 that we started together and we ended together. And it was in grade 10 that one of the most popular kids in our class was killed. And his name was Neil. And we had a teacher then, our guidance counselor, whose name is Holly Nordstrom, who made us all believe it was going to be okay. And she kept us connected to Neil's parents. She kept us connected to each other. And it was in that moment that I thought, that's what I want to do. I want to make people feel the way that she made us feel at 16 years old, that we were going to be okay in one of the biggest moments of our lives. So when I said that to my dad, I think I got it figured out, I want to be a psychologist, he was so friggin' happy about that because that meant that I might stop drinking at the Kinsella gravel pits. So he was like, what do we need to do to make this happen? So 13 years later, the poor bugger's still paying for things and we're doing fine, you know? So in the course of that whole process, I knew I really wanted to work with adults. I wanted to be a sports psychologist. I started at Red Deer College, where I don't remember much of that because I spent a lot of time in Billy Bob's. And then I went straight to the U of A, and I remember a little more of it. And I spent a lot of time there looking at sports psychology, trying to figure out how I could be the best motivator on the planet. There's no jobs in sports psychology. So I did an undergrad internship with the RCMP. And that is where, for 18 months, I worked with K Division and D Division. So these are our guys in Alberta and Northwest Territories. And I learned a lot about trauma. And I learned that we do very little to support our members. We do very little to support our EMS personnel, even today. And we do even worse of a job of supporting the families that hold them. And we struggle quite often in trying to figure out how we assist these people that we put in positions of helping us every single day to be better. And we keep pouring resources into them, and I think that's a massive mistake. I think it's the people who hold them that need the support. And so in that learning, when I did my residency in Nova Scotia, they said, you have to do a rotation with kids. And I said, I don't like kids. And they said, too bad, you have to. So I did, and I fell in love with the little buggers. Do you know how this happens? You don't want to like them, and then it just happens. And then you get some, you know, and then you really have to love them. So when I was there, I did a lot of rotation, or I did actually a postdoc with kids, and I learned that we know even less about kids and trauma. And I was so excited to come back to Alberta, and I got a position at the Alberta Children's Hospital on the inpatient unit where I stayed for 10 years. Hi, there's my SLP. Look at all of you. There, in those 10 years, I learned more from those kids and families than I could have ever learned in grad school. I learned what trauma looks like. I learned what brokenness looks like. I learned what disconnection looks like. And I spent a lot of time holding a lot of babies. And when they're at their worst states. We started there doing a lot of things from a very behavioral way. So 15 years ago, there was a lot of taking things away, putting kids in hospital pajamas. Show me when you're ready was our favorite statement. Yeah? The idea being that when you can figure out how to regulate emotion, when you can figure out to tell me what's wrong with you, then I'm going to help you. Until you get to that point, it's kind of up to you to figure that out. Okay? So much of that for us, for many of us, and we were young on that unit, said, this doesn't feel right. Why? You can't reward a kid enough to make them change behavior. This just can't be. This is a center of excellence. What are we doing? Yeah? So we spent a lot of time talking about emotional regulation, connection. Yeah? What are we missing in that piece? Because it turns out, when we think about the behavioral model, it's all based on a rat. Pavlov, Skinner, they came up with this idea. It's really friggin' lovely, right? Like, watch what happens when you shock a rat. They stop their behavior. Son of a friggin' gun. This is brilliant. What happens when we feed them a pellet? Oh, they do more. Cool. Let's try that with dogs. It works. Okay, let's base the entire education system and every parenting program on that. Okay, that's a good friggin' idea. What we failed to remember is that dogs and rats don't have a prefrontal cortex to make sense of the world, but we were like, it's all right. It works better. Let's just do it. Okay? And now we're in this position of trying to understand why it doesn't work. Why you can't take away enough from a kid to get them to regulate emotion or change their behavior. Huh? We wonder why that might be a problem. And so in the course of that time at the Children's Hospital, we were like, I think there's got to be something different. So we started talking about relationship and connection, and it freaked psychiatry out completely. You remember this? But we kept talking it because we were young and we had nothing to lose. And it was during that time that I met my husband, who's also old. And he feeds cows for a living. Like, how hard can that be? I don't know. I'm sure it's very hard. And it's delightful. And we get married, and he said we should probably be parents, and so we get one. We get a kid, and he's lovely, and I really think that working on a locked inpatient unit is way friggin' easier than being a parent, because as a child psychologist, I thought you were supposed to know what you're doing. Yeah, I didn't. It was awful. I hated it. So Aaron said, I think you better go back to work. And I said, you're right. So I loved that. Went back to work. And then he put twins in my belly at 36. Okay? Right? Does anybody own twins? You see, sister, we can drink together. I feel like tonight they should. Anyway, never mind. So does anybody have triplets? Because then I'll pay you money, like, to go on a vacation. So we get these children. I'm having a near psychotic break. I don't understand how you deal with this. My Aaron looks at me, my husband, and he's like, oh, this is getting really bad. And I'm like, you think? He said, I know what will help you. Let's move closer to my mom. Not even lying. And I was fully medicated at the time, and I woke up in Olds. In my mother-in-law's basement, where we lived for 6 weeks. Anyway, so there was great, and she really started to tick me off. So let me just give you the caveat, because she always asks me to say this, that I love her now, okay? And that if Aaron and I ever get divorced, which we won't because we're Catholic, but in case we do, that I will marry her. Because I love her. But at the time, I didn't, because she would say things to me like, Jode, I don't know why you're struggling so much. You know, like when I gave birth to your husband, I mean, I was picking apples. the day before on a ladder. And I popped them out, and I came home, you know, and I baked pies for the farmers with the apple. Good for friggin' you, you know what I mean? It's a different time now. And don't ever, let me tell you, this is a little tip for free. If you have not had two kids on the same day, you are not allowed to say to anybody, I know what it's like to have twins, okay? This is a little important thing you're just going to have to remember, because she said to me, she had boys that are 11 months apart. Yeah, so she, dude, I did it. Mm-hmm. So as we're breastfeeding in the middle of the night, she's not, because that's weird, but I'm doing it. She's supporting this process. She's telling me about what's happening in their classrooms because she's an EA. You know an EA? Anybody met an EA? Yeah, they like to tell you how to raise kids. They're the expert on children. Have you ever met an EA? Yeah, as they should be, because the only reason they're hired is for who? The kids that struggle the most. EAs are going to save the planet, which is why we need to spend more time looking after our EAs. So you, if you have a kid with an EA, you need to bring them snacks tomorrow, okay? We'll talk about that in a minute. Okay, so anyway, but she was kind of an old school EA, and she was talking to me a lot about the kids that are struggling in her classroom and what they were doing. So they were taking away recess, and they were putting them in the hallway, and they were doing these things to try to help these kids make better choices, yeah? And that makes my heart hurt. And so I said, because you're such a friggin' expert in parenting, let me tell you a little bit about what we learned at the Children's Hospital. Do you think I could come in and chat to your colleagues, like I'll bring snacks, about emotional regulation and connection? Would that be helpful? And she's like, yes, that would be great. Let's do it. I think they heard I swore quite a bit, and so they brought in the superintendent just so I wouldn't corrupt staff. They said she'd just be she would just happen to be in town. I doubt it. She like was a direct hit to be there. And she thought it was pretty good. And then she said, we should do this more often. And hey, we've had a cancellation at CAS. We need a keynote. Could you just give an hour talk at CAS? I said, sure, what's CAS? Just a little conference. I said, great. In Edmonton. And you know what? It is where all the superintendents go one time a year to Edmonton. So there's 400 friggin' superintendents in this room, like this, ball gowns, three-piece suits, very, very important in their educational prowess. And I roll in, like, not knowing what I'm getting into, swearing like a trucker from Viking, which, anyways, never, don't send me hate mail about truckers, because I know they don't all swear, but anyway. Because this is something that I believe to the core of me to be the reason that we can change the world, and it is about relationship and connection. And why educators to me become the most important people ever is because guess who spends more time or waking hours with our babies than we do? Educators. And here's why that becomes really important to me. There are so many discussions about how to do this parenting thing right that we kind of forget what we're supposed to be doing to do it right. Does anybody own a mother-in-law? Okay, so there's 677 opinions about how to do this right, right? If you don't coach every team, if you don't have a dolphin-assisted pool birth. Very bad. And sweet Jesus, if you don't breastfeed. Really bad choices, okay? So I'm going to show you this little video, which I think really depicts it all. I'm not up here to tell you how to do it. I'm up here to tell you one of the biggest lessons I've learned, and that is about the importance of connection with our babies. Not even our babies, but every baby that is in this room, everybody in our community, because we raise each other's babies, yeah? And when we talk about today, about lighting up with your baby and my baby, that's how we're going to change the world, yeah? So let me show you this idea about how many opinions there can be and what I think about opinions.
Police have arrived.
100% breastfed, straight from the source.
Drug-free pool birth, dolphin-assisted.
Oh.
Well, you push, we cuddle.
Yeah, cuddling is bonding.
Helicopter mom, 12 o'clock.
Must be mommy's day off.
Oh, that's sexist. What, you wanna go or something? No.
Ow, does
disposable diaper. Well, apparently we don't care about the environment.
Oh, look, it's Crunchy Granola Mom.
It's getting real.
I wonder what it's like being a part-time mom.
Ooh. Stay-at-home moms.
I wonder what they do all day.
Mani-pedis.
Looks like some moms are too lazy to breastfeed.
Someone came with their nipples blazing.
Oh, yeah? Well, I pop during conference calls.
Hello.
It's not all about the breasts.
Yeah, it is.
No, it's not.
You want a piece of this?
Oh, you want a piece of this? Well, I'll show you some scream-free parenting.
Bring it. Nibble up, ladies.
It's go time, I think. Yeah, go.
Let's go. Call me back.
Let's do this!
Oh, you guys. Gosh. Oh.
What I love about that is here's the deal, right? When we get down to it, here's what we're all here for, is to make sure our babies are going to be okay. Yeah? This is the quote that has guided me through many of these transformations in the way that we're thinking about things. We started off at this, you know, talk and cast 2 years ago, and since that time I've talked to your leaders in this province. I'm going to keynote a rural ed conference in March, and then we're going to do this on a Canadian basis at the end of March, talking to educators. We were in Halifax in July talking to the superintendents in Canada saying, we got to change the way we do things, guys. We're in a bit of a state of a mental health crisis. We're not in Uganda, but our kids are not getting better. Our teachers, our EAs, the people who hold our kids are not okay. What do we got to do about that? This quote by Marianne Williamson, she's written Return to Love, one of my favorite books of all time, says this, and it is my guiding force to many of the things that we do when I spend time away from my own babies, because I believe this to be so true. There is no single effort more radical in its potential for saving the world than a transformation of the way in which we raise our babies. That word transformation becomes so pivotal for me in thinking about what the problem is today, because I've heard so many times when parents say to me, can you see my kid? He's a disaster. I think he's going to be a psychopathic serial killer. I really think you need to see him. And I'm like, okay, yeah, I'd love to. Yeah, that sounds great, but I need to see you first. Huh? I've assessed and treated over 1,000 kids in this country, and I have never not one time met a bad kid. Not one time. The kids are not the problem, see? I can keep your kid in therapy till they're 65, and it doesn't matter a hill of beans if I send them home to Afghanistan every night. The kids are not the problem. We spend a lot of time, however, trying to figure out why kids these days are so lazy, are so disrespectful. Those Gen Y, X's, LMNOPs, little buggers, you know what I mean? I often hear parents say to me, you know, dad say to me quite often, you know, my father used to look at me. All he would have to do was look at me, and I would know that I need to pull it together. Now I look at my kid, I look at my boy like this, and you know what he says? What? Disrespectful. You know what we need to bring back? Spanking. That's what we need to bring back. That's a problem. Yeah. See, here's the thing. You know, the concern is the now screen time, social media, Grand Theft Auto 5. All of those things are the problem. See, none of those things are the problem in my mind. The biggest difference between what has come before us and where we are at now is one simple word, and it's called disconnect. The only way that you learn that you matter, the most important question you'll ever answer is, am I worth it? The only way you answer that question is in the context of relationship. And we are more disconnected today than we have ever been before. I want you to think about the square footage of the house in which your grandfather raised your father. What is the square footage in the house that you raise your babies? They had no choice, see? But to connect with each other and make things better. If I look at my grandparents, right? They were amazing. Every night, three games of crib. Yeah? Regardless of what was happening, three games of kids. She'd cuss his all things, and he would, you know, respond with, yes, ma'am, yes, Evelyn, mm-hmm, yeah. Every single night, three games of crib. Aaron and I are really lucky if I can sell him something on Hay Day. Like, that is the biggest conversation we have on this app that we play. Yeah, we farm in the same farming community. It's very lovely. Do you have a bolt for the barn? Yep, sell it to me. Don't you hike that price up. That is the best that we got going on between the two of us, see? What do we have that is so different than before? I mean, where is this all day long? They didn't have iPads or iPods. They didn't have TV. So guess what happened? So much of this happened so much more. And the only way I answer something very important, this question of am I worth it, is in the context of relationship. That is what has changed. It is so much easier to disconnect than it is to connect. It is so much easier when you have a big question about, do I matter? Have I screwed up? Did I make a bad choice? To put it on Facebook to say, I'm feeling really sad today. And 65 people within an hour will send you virtual hugs and likes and things, hearts and stuff. Yeah? It is much more time consuming to get in your car and say, hey, do you have 10 minutes I really want to talk about today? It was really rough. Yeah? The risk for rejection is massive. Yeah? So we take the easy road and we do what we can to get our needs met. Then what happens is we get our needs met in all other kinds of ways to be able to make sure we fill it, because we're all wired for emotional connection. We're all wired for relationship. So if we can't get it from other people, we get it from other things. Gabor Mate talks about this quite often. The opposite of addiction is not sobriety. It's connection. Because we will fill that hole of disconnect with many other things. If we don't think like we're good enough in relationship, if I don't know how to repair a relationship, I'm going to figure some way to fill it. The opposite of addiction is not sobriety, it's connection. Disconnect becomes the issue, because the only way that I answer this question of worthiness is around relationship. Yeah? Here's the tricky part. My friend Rita Pearson says this, and I say this oftentimes to your educators. I've said this to all of your teachers and principals in this division. Kids don't learn from people they don't like. And the most important lesson we're going to teach them is something called emotional regulation. Who owns a kid? You didn't come for the free cheese. You all own a baby or you love one, yeah? Your most important job as a parent, by the time you launch them at 18 or 25 or whenever they'll friggin' leave, is to teach them one thing and one thing only, and that is called emotional regulation. Because with emotional regulation, you can do anything. Do you know what I mean when I say emotional regulation? Not losing your friggin' mind, okay? How do you keep it together enough to have access to making good decisions? The only way you learn emotional regulation is in the context of relationship. Yeah? When you bring your baby home from the hospital, they have nothing on board other than to what? To let you know that they need something. How do they let you know they need something? They lose their friggin' mind. They cry. And what do? You cry as well, yes. Or you drink wine, or I'm just kidding. But usually in the beginning, your job is to figure out how to regulate them, right? You try to figure it out. You rock, you change bomb, you feed. If that doesn't work, what do? You go for a walk, you take them for a drive, you put them on the dryer, not in the dryer, but on the dryer, and you work to get them soothed, to get them regulated, because the more times you do that in your presence, the less it is required in your absence. Our only job as parents is to regulate for our baby so that when we launch them, they can do it for themselves. The more times you do that in your baby's presence, the less they will require somebody to do that for them in their absence, in your absence. Yeah? So your kid's job is to get dysregulated, and your job is to help them make sense of big emotion, because they don't have the neurological capacity to do that. Yeah? The more times you do that for your baby, the more times they wonder and they start to, I'm worth it, I matter. Look it, I got somebody who can catch me when I'm losing my friggin' mind. Perfect. Now I can take on the world. Yeah? How this is okay. So everything I'm going to talk about tonight is not new. This guy's dead. Most people that I'm going to talk about today are dead. Okay. Because this isn't fantastic new things. I say this to school boards all the time. I don't sell a shiny program. I don't think you need to do anything different than you're doing now. You need to operate from a philosophy of relationship and connection, and anything will work. Okay? The only thing, this is Yuri Bronfenbrenner, who I might have mentioned is dead. He started the American Head Start program in the 50s, the same time Pavlov, Watson, and Skinner were starting to say, like, if you just reward a kid enough, yeah, they'll do what you want. Yuri and another guy named John Bowlby, who we're going to talk about in a minute, but this guy said the only thing a kid needs to develop in a healthy way is that somebody has to be crazy about them. First, last, and always, that's it, end of story. Huh? Do you know what I mean when I say crazy? I mean, like, light up crazy. You know when you haven't seen your children for a long time, yeah? Or a day, and you do this like this. Light up crazy, okay? That is what kids need to know, that they matter. This is why people have dogs, see? Because we all want somebody or something to light up around us. And you can be the biggest friggin' jerk. I have not even swore once, you Catholics. Are you proud of me? You can be the friggin', so close, just slipped one there. You can be the biggest jerk on the planet, and you can come home and what does your dog do? So I can measure the health of a marriage based on how many dogs you have. Just kidding. Your trustee in the front row is like, shit, I have 5. Just kidding. But here's the truth of it. We all want somebody to light up around us. We never, ever outgrow that. And the truth of the matter is, it is easiest to light up around the people who don't need it as much. Think about the babies in your world, your kids' friends, the ones you worry about the most, the ones you've coached or the ones you've seen at school, at pickup or drop-off, who you've been so worried about. How many people are lighting up around them? How many people, when they see them, go, ah! They're usually named Jackson with an X, Chase, or Damien. I'm just kidding. Not really. So usually what happens is we respond very well to emotional regulation. If your kid is regulated and they know their manners, they can say hello, they are arriving on time, we respond very well to those kids, yeah? Good to see you. Hi, Miss S. Thanks so much, right? It's the little dudes who roll in 20 minutes late, backpack half open, they put one boot in the boot room, the other guy's still on because they had something to tell you. I got a Pokemon! What do we do for those babies? Look at me, right here. Eyes on. Zip it, okay? No, bup. Not Pokemon time. Look at me, you're in the red. Where does your boots go? No, we're not talking. Do you understand me? So we use some OT strategies, which are also very helpful if you march to the locker. It's not about OT strategies. It's about this kid is dysregulated. He has no capacity to learn, right? So is it okay that he enters our classroom or your house when his lid is flipped and he's dysregulated? No. It is not if I'm going to have a discussion with that baby. It's when. It is so much easier to light up around the kids who get emotional regulation. But the kids who need to be lit up around are usually the ones who need assistance with that emotional regulation piece. Yeah, you get it? We all want this to happen, okay? So this is your little homework because this is a school function. I feel like it'd be very appropriate to give you homework, okay? Who owns a spouse? Okay. So here's the other thing about the light up. We don't give it away to people who mean the most to us. Yeah? So when you go home tonight, if you didn't bring your spouse, this is what's going to happen in Calgary tonight when you go home tonight, okay? You're going to walk through the door. You're going to get eye contact. You might have to wake them up. And you're going to do this. Babe, come here. Come on. I just don't know if I tell you enough how much I love you and how lucky I am to have you in my life. I don't care what my mother says. It was the best decision to marry you. Okay, so what's going to happen when you do that in Calgary tonight? we're going to increase the population of the Calgary Catholic School Board, is what I hear happening. But what are they going to say to you? What would they say? What's wrong? What do you want? Are you loaded? I tried this. I mean, I got a website on this, but I tried this with my own personal husband, Aaron, not very long ago. And I said to him, you know, my personal husband, I only have one. And I was thinking, I was working with a particularly tough family, and I came home that day, and I was thinking, like, I'm so lucky. Like, he's not on crack. We have a spreadsheet for everything. God, like, he feeds cows. Like, how much more do you want from a man? And so I came through the door, and he was there with the kids, and I said, you know, babe, I feel so blessed, because we're Catholic, to be married to you. Do you like that? So I hung on for the 15 seconds I'm supposed to hang on for, and you know what he said to me when I pulled away? You know what he said? What'd you buy? Which is a good question for me, but I got a website on this, and he doesn't even trust the fact that my light up might be genuine. Right? So think about this disconnect that happens in our homes, right? Rarely do you walk through the door at the end of the day and make eye contact with the people you love. We usually are worried about what's for supper, who let the dog out, who's going to practice, right? Rarely do we take that time to look at each other and be like, hey, how was your day? Buddy, it's so good to see you, right? That light up is the thing we miss so much, because our opportunities to light up are not what they used to be. Yeah? We're trading floor space for friends, and we're keeping ourselves busier and busier and busier to make sense of the disconnect. Yeah? What matters more than anything, right? And my kids always surprise me this, you know, when we ask them what they'd like to do, and they always say movie night or let's play Uno, you know? It always is amazing to me. Because here's the tricky thing. When we teach our children, we teach our children's children. You cannot give away something you have never received. Yeah? You have to be taught how to apologize and be compassionate and have empathy. If nobody's ever done that for you, you cannot give that away. So in this province, in this country, we see multi-generations of abuse, neglect, and trauma, and we think the answer is to take the kids away. That is not the answer, right? We have to break the cycle. We have to speak to the parents, the caregivers that hold these babies, and hang on tight to them so that they can feed these babies again and again and again when they get dysregulated. Yeah? Kids in care are on medication 78% time greater than kids who are not in care. And you know what we're medicating? Dysregulation. The only way that I teach a baby how to regulate is in the context of relationship. And the more I do that for them, the better able they are to do it for the next generation. So here's the deal. If you screw up your kids, you're screwing up your grandkids. No pressure. Okay? You can't give away something you've never received. Okay? So in comes this idea of attachment, your superpower, right? And the word attachment becomes a scary word. If you don't Google it, well, Google attachment parenting, it's awful. This is not how it started to be, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about that in a second. But we learn most everything in the context of relationship. Most importantly, that thing called emotional regulation. And when you have emotional regulation on board, you have access to everything you will ever need to know in your life. Let me show you how important this idea of connection is, because we forget so much as parents. Are we enough, right? There is so many ideas about, you know, sorry, you don't have your kid in summer hockey, spring hockey, winter hockey, and purple hockey. All right. So they're in. You don't have them in basket weaving. They're not going to be very creative. No piano. They learn a second language best before six. They're not in French. Huh. Okay. Well, you make your choices. Frig off. None of that matters, okay? Less is more. Believe me when I say your babies want you, okay? I'm going to show you this little piece.
If you could have dinner with anyone, living or dead, who would you choose?
Kylie Minogue.
Oh.
Marilyn Monroe.
Oh, God, I wouldn't have a clue.
I know, straight up. Paul Hogan.
Kim Kardashian.
No.
I'd like to have dinner with Justin Bieber.
What? He's not coming to my house.
No.
I'd have Bob Hawke.
Dave Hughes.
Barry Humphries.
Jimi Hendrix.
People who have made a difference in the world, maybe Nelson Mandela at the dinner table.
I don't know what he's going to say. I'm scared.
If you could have dinner with anyone in the world, who would you choose?
Probably our whole family, like a whole extended family.
Mum and Dad. Mum and Dad.
Does it have to be a celebrity? Could it be family?
We love it. We talk about how school is. We ask Mum and Dad how their day was.
Family.
Yeah, Mum and Dad.
Family. Yeah.
Who would Elias like to have a dinner with?
They just want to be with us while they're eating food, which is pretty cool.
They see us above everything. I'm going to get...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Bit of a message in it for me.
Yes.
What are we having for dinner?
So you can imagine that it's these people sort of being interviewed about, you know, if you could have dinner with anybody. And, you know, people are coming up with all kinds of things. And the last thing they think about is their kids. And in 92% of the kids that they asked, that was the first answer out of their mouth, is our whole family. That's who I want to have dinner with. Yeah? And we often miss that opportunity because what happens at dinner time, right? This is a prime opportunity for this, but they don't know what they're asking for.
Hey guys, right? How's it going? Today, I want to show you my awesome new Wix website. It's got everything I love all in one place. Let me show you guys how I did it.
Yeah, we'll just close that, girl. So it's good. Yeah. Yep. Such good Catholics. They have Advent, where you open the door for chocolate.
So we were talking about if you could make a wish for Christmas that did not go under the tree, what would you wish for? And three or four of them came up to share their wishes with me. They didn't have to. I'd like to have supper with my family. I'd like to stay home at night and play a game. I'd like to go for a walk or a bicycle ride with my family. It was all about these 10-year-old children just wanting to do something with their family, not go to a sport, not be sent off here,
Isn't that something? Have supper together.
Yeah.
Isn't that something? And I think at the end of the day, right, what really matters about this stuff is that it's about you're enough. We wonder all the time, are we screwing our kids up? Is this a universal thing in Calgary? Because it happens in olds like every day. Okay, we feel like that is what we're doing every day, all day, and we wonder, are we enough? And it's so remarkable to me that sort of kids, you know, at the end of the day, this is all they want is time with you because they understand that the most important thing on the planet is that they need somebody in their world to assist them in regulating. Okay, so John Bowlby, I won't bore you with the theory behind this. Oh, now we have very big, important people. Hi, are you going to save the day? No? He's like, no, I'm just going to bring you water. Sorry. So, okay, you do your magic. Okay. So, So John Bowlby, he's dead. And he was the guy, he's touted as sort of the father of attachment. And he has said, it's said about him that he came up with this theory when everybody else was talking about behaviorism that said, emotional regulation is the most important thing you'll teach your kids. And he said you need two things on board to teach your kids emotional regulation. One is called secure base, and the other one is safe haven. And people are like, that's too many words. It's a lot of theory. We don't like it. We're going to go with behaviorism. When we look at what he was saying right now, he was actually talking about two very important things. Now, we're talking a lot about attachment parenting is all about love. If you just love your kids enough, they're going to be fine. That is not what John said. John says you need two things. You need love. Yeah, you do. You need to be able to give them a safe place to land. But you also need to be the secure base for which they will jump from. You need to be able to provide them the sense of, no matter what, I'm in charge. Limits, boundaries, no, I got you. And when you don't believe in yourself, I'm the one to believe in you. Get out there. You got this. Do it. Yeah? Those two things become really critical in teaching kids emotional regulation. So when you Google attachment parenting now, this is the hard part about it, is that, and this is what the psychiatry feared we were doing at Alberta Children's Hospital, is that we just wanted to rock kids till they were 65 and breastfeed till they're 10. Because if you just love them enough, they're going to learn emotional regulation. That is so not true. So you can do it all right, Yeah? You can do all those things that they say you should. Some, I don't know who it is that say you should, but breastfeed till they're 16. I'm just kidding. That's weird. But, you know, have the dolphin-assisted pool birth. You coach every friggin' hockey team on the planet. You bake for many things. You can do all of those things and have a beautiful relationship with your baby. You can do none of those things and have a beautiful relationship with your baby. It is not about the method. It's about the crazy. It's about the light up. Because I see dads deployed to Afghanistan for 6 months at a time who have a much more connected relationship with their babe than stay-at-home moms. You can be raising a kid in two different households and have a beautiful relationship with both parents. It is about the crazy. It is not about the method. And we spend a lot of time, thank you, Jesus. So can I just ask you a quick question before you leave, because I feel like I'll never find you again. I just want to see if I click over to a video, if it'll come, and it is. So can you tell me your trick, sir? Billy, what's your trick? Yeah, what happened? If this happens again, is there anything I need to know?
If you could have dinner with anyone living
Billy dead, assures us it will not happen again. Thank you so much. Yeah, Billy! All right, so again, this idea of you know, Bowlby comes up with this stuff, and it's backed up by science, which is what I love. Is anybody a nurse, a doctor, anything, background with the brain, anybody? Okay, well, I'm going to make this up, so you just be quiet, okay? This is the brain, because I really don't know what I'm talking about. I just read a book about it one time. This is the brain, and this is Dan Siegel's work. I don't know if you're familiar with Dan Siegel. He's a psychiatrist, an American psychiatrist, who changed the game for me when I started to understand what was going on for our babies that would just lose their friggin' mind on the unit, okay? This is the brain, and he says, here, let me make it really simple for you. If you make your fist, make a fist like this, put your thumb on the inside, and hold it up in the air. I'm watching you. There you are. Nice. Look at you. These Catholic parents. Okay. So this is your spinal cord, and this right here, your wrist, is sort of like the reptilian brain. So very primitive parts of the brain are happening here. If you flip your fingers up for a second, inside there is your limbic system. This is where fight, flight, or freeze lives. I say to Aaron, even cows have limbic systems, okay? So this is the very primitive part. In utero, when you were building your baby, this is the thing that developed first. Yeah? It's like a gift from Jesus. It is the three regulation strategies that you will have from the second you take your first breath until you die. It's like the things you get for free on how to regulate big emotions. Fight, flight, freeze. There are many people who go to their grave with only those things on board. Have you ever met a farmer? All they know how to tell you what they need is they lose their friggin' mind, right? They kick the chop pail around or they run. You own one of them? You ever seen one of them? Okay, I live in Olds, and I have a number of them on my... Anyway, it's delightful. What separates humans from all other mammals is we have a prefrontal cortex that wraps around that limbic system. That's represented by your hand. Your fingers, I mean. Everything that you've ever learned in your life lives in that prefrontal cortex. Like how to tie your shoe, what the PIN number to your bank card is, where you live, how many kids you own, how to speak a language, everything, huh? Most importantly, things like how to apologize, how to have compassion, how to have empathy. People had to teach you how to do those things so that it could fill that prefrontal cortex that you would then later have access to that, yeah? The more time I teach you something in that prefrontal cortex, the more likely it is it's going to stay, okay? When I have access to the things you teach me, and they sound like things like, you got this, you're good, come here, mama, look at me. The more times I soothe you, the more neural pathways that are there so that you can use them when you get bigger, yeah? Have you ever heard, okay, so when you have access to your prefrontal, this is who you are, okay? So when you decided to get married, yeah? Your partner had access to their prefrontal cortex, yeah? You ever heard that thing like, holy, she's flipped her friggin' lid? Does this happen in Calgary? You ever seen anybody flip their lid? Yeah? Flipping your lid means I'm going to pull that right off. I'm going to lose my mind for some particular reason because I'm into now fight, flight, and freeze. Something so big, so bad, so important has happened that I flipped out of the way everything I ever needed to know. and I'm going to go back to fight, flight, and freeze. See, this is really critical in the development of biology because I want you to be able to have that access to flip your lid in times of significant distress. When you flip your lid, you have access to all kinds of things, strength and adrenaline and things that you could do that you never believed. And I want those things on board, for example, when you're frolicking in the hills of Calgary and you come upon a cougar. Okay? You're out with your children on a hike and there's a lot of cougars in Calgary. So when you are out frolicking with your children and the lids are on and this animal comes that's going to eat you, I don't want you to have access to your prefrontal cortex. You no longer need to know what your PIN number to your bank card is. You no longer need to think like, gosh, I think I remember in biology 20. Is that like a lynx? Huh. It's friggin' beautiful. It's got big paws. Flip that out of the friggin' way and what? Fight, flight, or freeze. Hopefully not freeze. Right? And probably not fight. You're going to lose. So you want to run and hope your husband can catch up. Take the children and go. When in times of significant distress, we want access to that to get that prefrontal cortex out of the way. Okay? So when you bring your baby home from the hospital, that's all they have to do to tell you what they need is to flip their lid. Yeah? Our job over and over again when we put that lid on is we're creating neural pathways that assist them in understanding how to regulate emotion. So when I soothe you again and again and again and a friggin' again, yeah? 0 to 2, how many times are they flipping their lids? Every 15 seconds. Yeah? That's their job. Because they're flipping their lid so that they have somebody there to teach them how to regulate emotion. Here's the thing about lid flipping, yeah? Have you ever had the experience where somebody says to you, your son is so amazing, and you think, do you know me? Like, his name is Asher. Do you know him? Or they'll be like, your daughter is so kind. She's got the best manners on the planet. And you're like, you should have friggin' seen her last night. Parents say this to me all the time, right? They're like, why are they so nice to everybody else and they're such little souls to me? Why do they say me? Yeah, that is exactly what I want to have happen. Because the more time they lose their mind in your presence, the less they will require somebody to do it in your absence. So your job is to assist them in regulating emotion to the best of your capacity so that they learn to do it on their own. You think about, I say to Aaron, I want you to think about your prefrontal cortex like a wheat field, yeah? If you drive through a particular path on a wheat field again and again and again and again and again, what path are you going to take when a storm is coming? And you know what he said? You don't drive through wheat fields. I'm seriously telling you, it's going to be a long 50 years. But anyway. So I say, picture your prefrontal cortex as a meadow, no farmable ground, okay? If you drive through a path again and again and again, what happens in times of distress, what are you going to take? When there's a storm coming, what path are you going to take? The path of least resistance, right? So if the path of least resistance looks like, look, it's okay. Come on, try it again. You got it. If it looks like, shut up! Enough! Boys, don't get to your room. Get. That is what I'm going to have access to in my times of distress. That is what I'm going to have access to give away. Yeah? Here's the really interesting thing about lid flipping is that a prefrontal cortex is the only part of your brain that can learn. Your limbic system cannot learn. When do we like to teach our kids the most? When their lid is on or when their lid is flipped? When their lid is flipped. Because when they're losing their friggin' mind, what does it do to our lid? Yeah, because we panic, right? Rarely do you take a look at your kid when their lid is flipped and think, this is the perfect opportunity to train you to be a good mom for my granddaughter, okay? So mama's just going to keep her shit together right here, and I'm going to look at you and I'll be like, baby girl, come on, you got this. Yeah? Like, does anybody own a teenager? Yeah, and they come through the door. You've talked multiple times about not slamming the door, and you're cooking supper for the 155,000 friggin' time in your life, and they come through the door, and it goes bang! This is you. What's happening to your lid? Zip, zip, zip. How many friggin' times? And then you hear from your delightful little muffin of love, hey! What's for supper? And you say, excuse me? and they say, "What's for supper?" Now where's your lid? Disrespectful little. And you know who he reminds me of? The drunk alcoholic Uncle Walter. I knew he was coming out somewhere in this gene pool. Just like his father. Gotta crack down right now before he goes nuts on us all. So we have a hard time keeping our prefrontal cortex on because this kid is really ticking us off, right? So we might say things like, "It's friggin' meatloaf. Now get in here and be kind." Ah, meatloaf! I hate meatloaf! Do you know how to cook anything else? Again, if you're in my house, it might look something. Look at me, right now, right here. Are you freaking kidding me? You are gonna eat the meatloaf and you're gonna like it. I made meatloaf because your father doesn't like it either, so if you both want friggin' Cheerios, then go ahead! It's like so good, you know what I mean? Like regulated, passing on stuff, yeah? So in times of distress, we tend to lose our mind as well in an effort to pull our babies back on. But the deal is you can't regulate a flip lid with a flip lid. A flip lid also cannot learn. And so you can have the best, I say this to your teachers all the time, you can have the best pedagogical plan on the planet, but it's going to be ineffective if your kids aren't in a place to learn. So you can bring babies into the classroom and have things fly out of your whiteboard and have bulletin boards that match, but unless they like you, they are not going to have a prefrontal cortex to learn from you. Unless you have the capacity to regulate them in times of distress, they will not be able to learn from you. Yeah? And the only way you're able to teach a kid is when your prefrontal cortex is on. When you feel worthy, when you feel enough, that is when we do our best teaching. Yeah? Those are the times where we feel like, bring it. You got that? Is that all you got today? Yeah, I got you. Yeah? The more times we do that for our babies in our presence, the less they require somebody to do it in our absence. So the power in the superpower is this idea of lid flipping. When kids are distressed, our first goal is to get their prefrontal cortex back on. Now, this is so tricky because it flies in the face of all reason. Every behavioral intervention that we've ever been taught says things like, consequences must be immediate. And if you don't give a consequence immediately, what happens? It's very bad. They'll become psychopathic serial killers. It's very bad. They will then be able to rule the roost. They will not know who's boss. They will be disrespectful. They will run over you. You got to be in charge. Yeah? This is very true. You do have to be in charge. It is not if I'm going to have a discussion about a choice you're making. It's when. Because if I don't have a prefrontal cortex, then I don't have anything. Yeah? Make sense? Here's the people that made it make complete and utter sense to me, and they are not dead. They're four delightful men out of Seattle, Washington, who came up with a theory called circle security. Anybody ever hear about this before? Circle security? Yeah, cool. So it changed my life as a therapist, and we employed it on the Children's Hospital every single second that we could because it made sense to me. These guys, and I'm going to just tell you really quick, these guys said, they took Bowlby's theory and said, listen, we're working with teenage moms. These are women, young girls who come from multiple histories of abuse, neglect, and trauma. And they don't know that their most important capacity is their relationship with their baby. That is the only thing that they have to do. When their babies get distressed, it's not their fault. When their babies get distressed, they're actually trying to learn something. How can we teach them that? How can we tell them the importance of emotional regulation? And he said, okay, I got it. If you are a regulating other for a kid, if you are an important figure for a kid, you're a coach, you're a dad, you're a mom, you're a grandparent, you're a Sunday school teacher, you're any of those things, you are in a position to assist a kid in learning how to regulate emotion. You become for them hands on the circle. They say, think about it like this. When you go to a park, say you have a three-year-old and you're taking them to a park, yeah? You drive to the park. You and the kid have your lid on, yeah? Have you done this? You're frolicking in the joys of parenthood, yeah? So great. Their lid is on, your lid is on, your bucket is filled, whatever thing you want to use. You get into the park, you sit on the bench, you are their hands. Their job is to then explore and play. Okay? If their lid is on, they are going to be able to go to the top of their circle and explore. This is where curiosity lives, at the top of the circle. I say this to all your educators. This is where I want your babies to be in a classroom, top of the circle, because they can turn around and look at dad or mom and say, are we good? And you can say, yes, babe, go play. I'm right here. I'm going to watch. Yeah? out to the top of the circle they go. They have access to their prefrontal cortex so they can look at things like the trees and the sky. And, oh, I love, oh, those kids. Do they look like they're going to be nice to play with? Because I can picture their faces and make a decision about whether I want to engage with them or not. Yeah? Twirly slides. I love twirly slides. On the twirly slide they go, they fall off and they skin their knee. What happens to their lid? It flips. Right? You rarely see a kid with a skinned knee dragging it because they're just so excited they got to get to the swings, you know? They get dysregulated, their lid flips, and what do they need to do? They need to come back into the bottom part of the circle to what? Get regulated. So little guys are really easy. They almost feel like it's like a tell in poker. You can tell when their lid is flipped because it sounds like a fire engine. Yeah? So easy. They come in, and what do? At the bottom part of the circle? Let me see you come here. You give a kiss, you put a Band-Aid on, you do all those kind of things to help them regulate emotion. And when they regulate emotion, where do they go? Out to the top of the circle and back out again, right? Oftentimes, though, if you're my father, you're going to say if it's not bleeding or broken, you don't make eye contact, which is why I'm in therapy for the rest of my friggin' life, because he screwed it up. Anyway, so, but the bottom part of that circle is that place where I'm gonna put that lid back on, so come to me, right? Sometimes they cue us that they're ready to go, right? The full charge wiggle happens, and we're not ready to let them go. We're still checking for broken bones. You ever seen that? They're like, let me go to the top of the circle. And you're like, no, mommy, really, ma. This is a big thing at kindergarten drop-off. Mm-hmm. This is called a cue and a miscue, and that's where everything starts to go south, actually, when we don't get our cues correct, yeah? But that's another day. But really, what happens is I want them up to the top of the circle. And when they go up to the top of the circle again, they can go out there and explore, and something else really big is going to happen, and it can be a good thing. They can find something that they cannot do anything other than tell you. They cannot continue to play. This is such a big friggin' deal that the world is going to stop. They cannot go on to the next choice until they come and tell you, Dad, look what I found. And you're like, what is it? And they're like, because it's a cigarette butt. And you're like, they're like, it's a dinosaur tooth. You're like, yes, it is. We have to show your mother. This is amazing. Friggin' rights, you do. Lid goes back on, out to the top of the circle they go. Yeah? Now that you know about the circle, you will see kids doing this every day, all day. The younger they are, the more they flip. Yeah, the more distressed they are, the more they flip. The more it's something they have. Anyway, so in, out, you'll see it in Walmart and doctor's offices. They go, when they get too far away from people who can regulate emotion, what do? They come back in. Yeah? As long as we can get this right, here's the thing I want you to take home. This is so critical. If you listen to anything that I say, listen to this. You only need to get this right 30% of the time. Woo! Thank you, Jesus. You can screw this up 70% of the time and still teach your kid how to regulate emotion. This is amazing, right? It's okay because we're going to be tired and exhausted and we're not going to get it right so many times, right? And it's an average. You can dip into the 20s. Totally okay, right? Our job is to figure out how many times we can give you the best opportunity to regulate emotion as much as we can. And when I'm on my game, I got you all day long. And when I'm having a struggle, I know that I can make up for that later. Yeah? There's a small exception to this rule, but 30% of the time is what we need to be doing to assist our kids in regulating emotion. The deal is that how do we do this? I mean, we have these conversations all the time. How do we do this? When we hit adolescence, right, when we get into adolescence, is it all become lost? This idea of neurological pathways, if we miss it in this time of circle secure, or sorry, this time of 0 to 6, this is what these guys sort of based it on. When we get into adolescence, is it still important? What do you think? How come? Yeah, so kids are, I'm just missing a video in there. I'm going to find it for you. What happens is, here's what we think. Who do we want kids to spend the most time with as they get into adolescence? We do want that, but what do they end up spending time with? Yeah, and we think we don't matter so much anymore, huh? Here's another sort of faulty way of operating, because the interesting thing about this for me is that when we think about it from a neurological perspective, the only time that kids flip their lids more often is 0 to 2 than during adolescence.
Smile.
Sweet Lord, at least they're not eating a Tide Pod. Here's the deal. Once they get to adolescence, we start to think, okay, they're going to spend more time with their friends. Our job is kind of done. They're a little bit better at regulating. They got language, right? We can step back a little bit, yeah? Here's the problem. The lid flipping happens so significantly in adolescence. What is going on for these guys in adolescence? So much hormones. Here, you're in grade 10. Your father and I would like to know what you're going to do with the rest of your life. What's your choice? Mm-hmm. Are you going to get high? Are you going to vape? Are you going to have sex? What are you, are you skipping school or no, you're not? Here's a 2,000-pound piece of metal. Could you just drive that slowly? Try not to be cool, okay? So many things on their plate. Are you too fat? Should you be dating? What about an STD? Yeah. All of these things are going on to flip their lids, and we have this idea that we should help them spend more time with their peers who are also doing what? Flipping their friggin' lids. Great idea. Yeah? We want to create, what's happening during adolescence is a state of pruning. The pathways that are used most often during adolescence are the ones that are going to stay, because there's so much stuff in there that we fill their little brains with as babies. What we want is for them to use the pathways that are going to be used most often, right, in adolescence. So here's the thing. It is not about, we have so much more time when they're little. We have so many more opportunities to help them regulate. During adolescence, we have to seek them. Yeah? When is the time that you have the best talk with your adolescents, your preteens, your teenagers? Where are you? In the car, because they're locked and they can't get out. Here's the thing, right? Bedtime is also really a time where we can sort of have these conversations, because over and over and over again, big things are going through their heads. There's big lid-flipping moments. Timing becomes so critical. Have you ever taken a group of 15-year-old boys to a hockey game? And there's the driver, they think there's a cone of silence, apparently, in the 36 millimeters that separates you. They think you can't hear anything. So the people, those four little buggers in the back seat, who are usually named Connor, Dylan, Tanner, and Kyle, are having discussions with each other about chicks and Tide Pods. And they're saying things like, oh yeah, she's totally hot, dude, like you should bag her. As a parent, is this the perfect opportunity to pull over and line up those little muffins of love and slam their frontal cortexes back on and create a neural pathway? Here's the thing, you're the boss, so you get to choose. So if I'm driving along Highway 2 and I see you got six little hockey players lined up, I'm gonna honk honk. I'm gonna know what's happening. But for me, it becomes really important that I have time to have access to a prefrontal cortex. So immediacy does not matter in this moment. I'm going to take him to the hockey game. I'm going to cheer my heart out for these babies. I'm going to bring them back home. I'm going to drop off those other four friggin' disrespectful kids who are no doubt influencing my sweet muffin. And I am going to give him some hot chocolate. We're going to sit at the table. We're going to talk, because here's the thing. Food is your biggest thing on the planet, because you can't chew with a flip lid. It's impossible, see? When's the last time you just were so mad you wanted a sandwich? So you feed them when you're going to teach them something important. So we're having our hot chocolate, and I'm going to say to my little muffin of love, I'm going to say, do you know what? I'm so proud of you today, buddy. You played so good. I love you. You get this idea of passing back to the point, and I love how you played that position so well today. Oh, yeah, thanks, Mom. And then I'm going to say, you know what I'm not so proud about? What? You know when you and Connor and Tanner and Dylan and Kyle were talking about begging that chick in the back seat of the car there when I was driving you to your game? Oh, Mom! I was just trying to be cool. I know you were, but look at me. I'm a chick and so is your sister. And we don't talk about women like that. You understand me? Never again. Okay. Yeah? Those opportunities become the times that we assist our adolescents in making good choices, because there is so much on their plate. They want to do great, they want to do well, but their capacity to tell us is not in line with their capacity to talk. Don't you ever forget that. When they say get away, that never means get away. Let me show you this little video, okay? Now, I don't know who put this together. We've tried for years to find them. There's no response, but it is brilliant. I want you to watch their take on what happens in adolescence and how critical secure relationships matter.
Time of day I can't recall, the kind of thing that takes a toll. Over years of overtime, over smiles and over wine. All in all, it wasn't bad. All in all, it wasn't good. But I still care. And that's the problem with the days. Are never long enough to say what it is you never said. All the books you never read. Throw myself into the wind, hoping somebody might pick me up and carry me again. Where are you now? Do you let me down?
Great, huh? Here's what I love about that. The song is called Pride and Joy, and I had never heard it before, and I haven't heard it since. It's by Brandi Carlile, who is a singer-songwriter out of Seattle. Has anybody ever heard of her? Brilliant. It's what they're talking about is, you know, when my oceans turn to drops and my mountains turn to rocks, when everything is falling apart, am I still your pride and joy? Do I still matter? Are you still going to light up around me when everything is going absolutely backwards and I'm going to be making all kinds of bad decisions? Do I matter? Yeah. So when we think about this idea of how do we sort of get a kid's lid back on in times of distress, how do we stay connected to them in times of distress, here's a few things that you know to the core of you as a parent that works, but we sometimes forget it when we're overwhelmed and exhausted and our own lids are flipping and we're thinking we're screwing up, yeah? Here's how you get a lid back on. You show genuine interest in things you could give a rip about. Okay? So you become really good at things like Pokemon, and you know all the stuff. And if you don't know, especially in this preteen, teenage world, what's cool, because it changes every friggin' day, guess who the number one expert is? Them. So you ask them. Yeah? They usually walk around with them earbuds in their ears, yeah, listening to God knows what. You show genuine interest in things you could care less about. You say, hey, what's in there? I want to download a new track. For my Walkman. Don't say that. You say, what are you listening to? They're going to say, you're not going to like it anyway. There's swear words in it. You say, too bad. I'd love to hear it. What are you listening to? And when they say the Insane Clown Posse, you're going to say, Wicked. And then you are going to take that earbud, you're going to hold it up close to your ear, you don't put it in it, you'll get a disease. Listen, and when this happens on the other end, you're going to do this. You're going to say, this is so good. And then you might say, because it's fodder for discussion then, what are they saying? Have you ever seen them in concert? Like, can they get out of their country? Do you know those sorts of questions, right? It sounds just like Fishing in the Dark. You heard that song? It provides an opportunity for you to wonder what's going on. You ask them to teach you how to use Snapchat and Instagram. You say to them, even if you know, you say, show me how I make my face do this. With the dog thing coming out. How do I do that? Come on, let's do one. Let's do a selfie. Yeah? You get them to teach you stuff like that because they want to talk about it. You speak to them about things like 13 Reasons Why. The second season is coming out this year, and it's about a school shooting. What happens when we say to kids, you can't do those things, you can't talk about them, we're not letting you watch them? What do? They do it. I'd much rather you be alongside to assist them in regulating emotion and say things like, do we have a Hannah at our school? Is there somebody we need to be worried about, dude? Have you ever thought about stuff like this? 13 Reasons is, I'm sure you know, right? It's a Netflix series about a girl who documents her successful completion of suicide. And there was a big backlash. It's based on a book, actually, about, oh my gosh, we got to stop kids from watching this because it's going to give them ideas. Let me tell you, they have these ideas already. And when we talk about it, 1 in 4 have a plan. Kids Help Phone Data, this time last year, came out with some statistics, not American statistics, but ours, that would say 1 in 5 teens have considered a plan, which means in a classroom of 20 kids, that's 4. Yeah? Our best intervention is connection, and this is why I feel so blessed to get your educators every single day that this division is saying, tell us how we can do this better. I'm saying all we need to do is light up. And unless we look after our educators, we're not going to be able to do that for our babies. When you get a chance to tell a teacher or an EA or a bus driver or a secretary that they're amazing, you do it. Because all we want to know is that we're doing a good enough job. And when we feel like we're doing a good enough job, guess what? We're in the game. Have you ever had anybody tell you you're amazing? Have you ever had anybody tell you your kid's amazing? What does that do for you? Yeah? It costs nothing. I'll tell you this little story. When I was in Red Deer not very well a while ago, I love to tell this story. I was driving past Billy Bob's, remembering my glory days of 93. And we were going to a Connect training, a parent training, and I had a nurse, Melissa, was with me from the Children's Hospital, and we were parked at a light by Billy Bob's. I don't know if I mentioned that. And I looked behind me in the rearview mirror, and there's a mom rocking it out, like dancing like you don't even know, in a minivan. Things are happening like it was the 80s, and I was watching her, and I said to Melissa, oh, my God, look at this mom. She's amazing. She has a 13-year-old kid beside her in the seat, maybe 13, and he's, like, mortified. Would do anything to get out of that window if he knew he wasn't going to be left behind. Now, this little monkey had a helmet on, and so there must be some developmental delay going on for this kid. But I was watching her rocking it, and so Melissa and I are both, you know, looking in the rearview mirror like this, like watching, and we miss the light, people honking, everything, yeah? So we go around the corner, and I say, oh, my God, she's amazing. And Melissa said, where are you going? I said, I got to tell her. And she's like, oh, God. Right now? I'm like, I don't know that I can find her again, you know? So she's like, well, we got to get to training. I said, I know. I hope she's not going to Lacombe, but we got to do this. So I pull in behind her. She didn't live far. Melissa's saying to me, take off your sunglasses! So I did. And I got out of the car, and I knocked on the window, and she rolled down her window, and I said, hey, Mama, I just wanted to tell you your dance moves are amazing. She's like, okay. And I said, I don't know who this little guy is beside you, but he's pretty lucky to have you. And I just want you to have a good day. And she's, do you know what she said to me? Thank you. I needed that. And I got back in my car, and I put my sunglasses on, and I watched her carry this baby into the house because he's immobile. Yeah? It took me 30 seconds. Cost me nothing. I wasn't late for training. Is she in the game? Yeah. We have this to give away in our communities every single day. We all walk through this world wondering, are we serving our children well? Are we serving our partners well? Tell each other this every chance you get. I try to do with dads, and then they think I'm picking them up, so I always have to be like, married, however, I think you rock. Yeah. You have the opportunity to do this all the time. Take it. My gosh, we want to know. We want to know. Yeah. We are raising each other's babies. When you light up around my baby at the hockey rink and I light up around your baby at Sunday school, huh? That's how these kids are going to know they matter. That's the answer to the mental health crisis. Looking after all of us who are holding these little people. We can pour resources into them till we're blue in the face. Anti-suicide, anti-bullying, what do you call those? Fentanyl, what the frigate? Don't eat a Tide Pod. It's very scary that we have to have these conversations. We can do that all day long, right? The issue is not about treating kids. The kids are the least of our worries. Unless we hang on to the people, the big people in their world, these babies are not going to be okay. Eye contact becomes so critically important, yeah? Because how I regulate a kid, how I regulate emotion more quicker than anything on the planet is eye contact. People say to me all the time, you have to be careful about cultural sensitivity around eye contact. Yep, I got it. But here's the deal. There is not a culture on this planet that doesn't use eye contact to emotionally regulate. Not one time. Some people do it through veils. Some people aren't allowed to do it with certain genders. Sometimes it happens very quickly. But I do this to know where I stand with another human being if I'm regulated. Sometimes when I'm scared, I do that too. Where are the eyes when somebody you know has anxiety or depression? Where are the eyes in the hall room of many high schools? Where's the hoodies? Where's the hair? Because these are the window to the soul, and when I don't understand what's going on behind there, I don't feel like I can show them to you. The answer is not an anti-hoodie policy or cut your hair. It is, why are they down? These three words I take to work every single day. Tell me more. We want to fix all day long. Our kids come home and they say, I hate this kid on the playground and nobody played with me today. What do? We come up with strategies. We base an entire IPP system on strategies. Yeah, here's the strategies we can do. Forget it. Strategies are irrelevant unless we know why. Tell me more. You get on their level. You feed them. This food thing, my God, I'm telling you. I am the mom in Walmart who is busting out popsicles at 7 a.m. just to keep their shit together before I get my groceries out. You know? You want a piece of bread? You bet. Let's open the bread. Good idea. Yeah? I do what I need to, you understand. This idea of feeding works very good for your husbands too, I'm just telling you. When you want to do something, feed first, and then you have a prefrontal cortex. They have access to everything they know. Also, this idea of you never leave them. See, You see, kids can't regulate by themselves. They can't regulate emotion. Their lid can't come back on in a really developmentally appropriate way by themselves. It will fall back on if we say, and this is my number one favorite thing to do, when you threaten relationship, things happen really quickly because our biggest fear on this planet is abandonment. Yeah? So when I say to my kids, you ever try this? Smart upper mommy's leaving. It works really good, eh? Yeah? That you shouldn't use that a lot because that's bad. But you can do it 70% of the time. It works because we know that we need somebody else to co-regulate. Otherwise, we can't do it ourselves, yeah? And so when somebody says, you know, timeouts, I'm a massive believer in timeouts, not for your children, but for you. Because you can't regulate them if you're dysregulated. So I give my kids timeouts all the time. I give them breaks. Mommy needs a break right now. I'm going to be back in 2 minutes, I promise you. And you go. You must honor that idea if you can do it 70%. But the deal is, you know, when you say go to your room, they often go like, oh, right, I got it, sure. I'm just going to go while you get your lid back on. Does that happen? No. So then what happens is you must remove yourself as long as they're safe. So I like to do that in the bathroom where I lock the door and they're safe. And then I have a bottle of white in the tank of the toilet because then it's chilled at the ready. Do you know what I mean? Nobody knows. Your mother-in-law has no idea. I'm just kidding. I'm really kidding. Not really. So... But the idea is, I want you to take 30 seconds whenever you can to be like, so that you can stay in the game and be able to do this for your babies, right? Because they can't do that on their own. Okay, I know we're running a little bit short of time. Here's my girlfriend. I kind of want to marry her. So her name is Brené Brown, and she is like my hero. I have a massive girl crush on this girl. She has written some amazing works called Daring Greatly, Rising Strong, Braving the Wilderness. If you ever need a book to warm your soul, any of those three will do it for you. I followed this woman around the country. There has been security guards involved a couple of times. But before I die, me and this girl will be on Super Soul Sunday together. This is my plan, okay? One of my favorite quotes on the planet that she says is, the truth is, rarely can a response make something better. What makes something better is connection. And we spend so much of our time worrying that we're not saying the right thing or teaching our kids the right lesson. We're getting it wrong all the time, right? The truth is, rarely can a response make something better. What makes something better is connection. Think about this, and this is how it rings true for me. In your most significant time of grief, when you have been your saddest on the planet, what did you need? Oftentimes, what we decide when we're on the other side of that, when somebody's lost somebody, we think about a lot, what do we say? I don't know what to say when somebody's lost a child or a husband. Oh, God. Should I bring the meatloaf, like the meatballs or the buns? God, I don't know. They probably have too much food. You know what? I'm going to just, I'll wait till later because I didn't really know them any, you know. When you have been at your lowest point ever and you opened that door to somebody, did you care if they were hanging onto balls or buns? You didn't. Because that becomes irrelevant, right? In times of most significant distress, what we want is somebody to connect to us. Yeah? We all have that capacity. Yeah? So, I love this. This is a Rumi quote. Raise your words, not your voice. It's rain that grows flowers, not thunder. What I love is this also... What does this have to do? What does this parenting stuff have to do with our partners? Well, it actually has everything to do. Are you getting anxious? Oh, we are getting a little bit pressed for time. Sure, darling. Okay, yeah. No, I got. I'll wrap her up. So, what does this parenting stuff have to do with your partners? Here's the deal: we are very bad at collecting before we direct our partners. Yeah? We like to fix stuff all the time. So this stuff of connecting with your kid, getting their prefrontal cortex on before you give a direction, has to do, it plays out exactly with our partners. In the beginning, how good were we at sort of giving grace to everything that our partners would do? Were we way better in the beginning? Did you light up more in the beginning? Yeah. You know that they used to blow their nose. It was like cute and stuff. Or actually, they didn't even. I don't remember that. And now there is a, he likes to refer to it as the allergy honk. And I'm not so sure he has allergies, but he friggin' does. Stop it! So what does this parenting stuff have to do with our partners, right? We have little grace to give our partners again and again and again because the issue is disconnect. When we try to fix all the time, we want you to be in a better place. We want you, here's the answer. Here's what I need you to do, right? If you do the last time you came home from work and you've had the awful, you know, this is awful, awful, awful. What do you want your partner to do? Right? What do they say? You know what, like, again, seriously, why don't you just quit, okay? How helpful is that? Right? It's like in the history of telling somebody to calm down, when has calm down worked? Right? The last time your husband just said to you, oh, calm down, did you say, oh, babe, seriously, thank you, sweet pea. This is why I married you. Do you want to make out? This idea of connecting matters so much. And what we do is we get so implored to fix, especially the more time we spend with people, because we take it as our responsibility to be that fixer. Let me show you this quick little video before we take some questions, because I think this is really kind of cool.
It's just, there's all this pressure, you know? And sometimes it feels like it's right up on me. And I can just feel it, like literally feel it in my head, and it's relentless, and I don't know if it's gonna stop. I mean, that's the thing that scares me the most, is that I don't know if it's ever gonna stop.
Yeah. Well, you do have a nail in your head.
It is not about the nail.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, I'll bet if we got that out of there...
Stop trying to fix it.
No, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm just pointing out that maybe the nail is causing...
You always do this. You always try to fix things when what I really need is for you to just listen. No,
see, I don't think that is what you need. I think what you need is to get the nail
out. See, you're not even listening now.
Okay, fine. I will listen. Fine.
It's just... Sometimes it's like... There's this achy... I don't know what it is. And I'm not sleeping very well at all. And all my sweaters are snagged. I mean, all of them.
Yeah, that sounds really hard.
It is. Thank you. Ow!
Come on, ow. If you would just-
Don't!
Try to see things my way. Do I have to keep on talking till I can go?
Isn't that fabulous? It is so hard. It is so something that we want to do is to fix. And so the issue for me is like, how do we look after each other when we get through this process? Your kids are only as okay as you're okay, right? I don't ever want you to forget how much you matter. In the context of your community, in your family, in your church, lighting up around each other, connecting the best that you can. Tomorrow when you go through Tim Hortons, you look at them in the eye and say, thank you for this latte. It freaks them out. Use their name. Then they're always like, do I know you? Baby girl, you have your name tag on, remember? You know? This idea is the only way out for me. And don't you ever, ever forget, if you could only sense how important you are to the lives of those you meet, how important you can be to the people you may never even dream of, there is something of yourself that you leave at every meeting with another person. That's what Mr. Rogers said, and it's still true to this day. You light up around those babies, you light up around those people that you love the most. And when you question whether you can stay in the game, I want you to think about who your bottom hands are. Who are the people that remind you you're awesome? Spend time with them. If they're not here anymore, you think about them. Many people who no longer walk the face of this earth are the people who keep me in the game. One of my good friends, Tara, who lost her battle to cancer, she has kids the same age as I do. When I question whether I'm a good mama, and I spend a lot of time away from my babies doing this because I believe it to be so true, when my kids say to me, Mom, can you be home tonight? And I say, you know what I'm going to do tonight? My second favorite job. Talking to kids and families. You know what my first favorite job is? And they always say, hanging out with us. I say, you're right. And as soon as I'm done my second favorite job, tomorrow night we're going to do this. Is that cool? Yeah? Tarot reminds me every single day, especially when I forget it, that Sydney would give anything to hear her say that. So guess what? I'm going to live well for the both of us. I'm a good mom, and I do this stuff really good, and you can do both. All you got to do is light up. All you got to do is be crazy. So listen to me very carefully. From the bottom of my mama heart, I own three of them, as you know. I want to thank you so much for coming out tonight, and I know what a massive commitment it is to be away from your house, away from your children. I appreciate it to the core of me. We will change the way that babies think about themselves when we start to look after each other. So light up as much as you can tomorrow. Go home tonight. Light up around the people you love the most. And I just want to tell you, you're amazing. Thank you so much for being here tonight.
So on behalf of the Board of Trustees, I'm very appreciative of the opportunity to close out the evening. It's important to the Board of Trustees that we have this chance to engage with our parents who we represent. I hope this forum offered you the chance to enlighten and enhance your relationship skills with your kids. You know what to do when they flip their lids, and you know that you got this. I would love to thank Dr. Carrington for her insight, for her honesty in sharing her experience. And especially for her friggin' sense of humor. Dr. Carrington, please accept this token of our gratitude on behalf of our district. Thank you. As a district, we recognize the need to support the whole child, including the critical mental health components. And one of the ways we are doing this is the implementation of our Champion program. Every child deserves to have a trusted adult in their life that they can go to for support and compassion. This starts at home with you as parents. But when your children walk through the doors of their Catholic schools, there are secretaries, there are administrators, teachers, support workers, and janitors who are raising your babies. Each of them have the caring capacity to be that champion. Each and every one of our schools has implemented this mentoring program for kids who really need it. I think you can agree that the world certainly needs more champions, because as Dr. Carrington says, if you have someone to catch you, you can take on the world. Thank you so much for attending tonight. Just a couple of housekeeping items. The presentation has been videotaped and will be shared on our district website, but not until after the March 13th forum, where Dr. Carrington will return for a repeat engagement with a whole new group of parents. Please complete the feedback sheets on your table. We need to know how to be better and do better, so your comments are very much appreciated. And if you could, please share what you've learned tonight with your respective school councils. Please join me as we come together for our closing prayer. We begin our prayer together by marking ourselves with the sign of our faith. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord of all times and seasons, as our time together comes to an end, we again lift our hearts and minds to you, divine source of life. Continue to transform our hearts and minds and help us to grow in love and friendship, recognizing that we are all members of your family, each fully loved and equally called to proclaim the gospel of Christ with our lives. Bless our sons and daughters and help them to be successful students who have meaningful relationships in life. Guide them in their efforts to pray and enkindle within their hearts the divine fire of your Holy Spirit, that they may know the depth of your love and discern their own unique call. May they grow daily into the image of your Son and learn to love as freely and as generously as he loves. Through Christ our Lord, amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Please drive safely home to that someone who lights up when you walk through the door. whether it's your kids, also known as a muffin of love, your spouse, or your five dogs. God bless.